Okay, everybody. I promise we'll give you more socializing time at the end of the session. Do we all feel like we're back in school? You've all done so well this morning. Thank you all for being here and chatting together and joining us today. My name's Megan. I'm a support nurse from Brisbane, and I'm sharing the next session with Alicia. Put your hands up if you know Alicia. I hope that everybody knows. If you haven't met Alicia and Joe, who's working very hard with the doctors upstairs, make sure you make yourself known. This is your Adelaide superstar, our South Australian support nurse for Myeloma Australia. And she's got all the local ins and outs. And she told me about the Portuguese tarts, which I had no idea about at the markets. It's changed my life. Do I need to announce something? Is this a football score? Gosh. Our next session ties in really nicely from our last session. If you're ever in Queensland and you come to one of my groups, I bang on about this all the time. We want you, when you're living with myeloma, we want you to be the captain of your ship. Now, it's a very complicated ship that you're running, and you have to employ some pretty good crewmates. But at the end of the day, it's your ship, and we need to be guided by you as the captain of which way you want to go. So I want to introduce our next speaker, who's joining us today from Capri. This is the beautiful Maya Joshi. She is a research manager at Capri, which is an independent consultancy focused on high-impact research to improve engagement and understanding of community and health consumer needs. Maya is passionate about using patient preference research to meaningfully integrate patient values into healthcare decision-making at both an individual and systemic level. This includes centering patient voices in treatment discussions with healthcare teams, as well as at a policy level when deciding what treatment options people have access to. Maya's background is in patient advocacy, patient education, and patient-centred research in the field of rheumatology. She's now moved into the myeloma space, and you'll notice on your tables that orange pamphlet, and Maya's going to be talking on that today, so if you need to reference that later on. Thank you so much, Maya.
Thanks, Megan. So I'm Maya, and I'm going to be discussing an online tool that was designed to help facilitate shared decision-making conversations between patients and their healthcare team. And I think it's the perfect time for this, as just before lunch, Donna gave an overview about shared decision-making and why it's important in myeloma. But as a quick refresher, shared decision-making is where you and your healthcare team work together to make treatment decisions, so that treatment decisions not only incorporate your clinical circumstance, but also your personal circumstance and preferences. Okay, so I'll start with a bit of background. As Megan said, I'm a research manager at an organization called Capri. This stands for Community and Patient Preference Research. We specialize in conducting research to understand people's values and preferences, including those of patients, carers, healthcare providers, and community members. Overall, our work aims to help groups like government, industry, and healthcare systems make decisions based on what people value, or in other words, make decisions that are aligned with the values of the people actually impacted by the decisions they make. Oops, sorry, can I go back quickly? Thanks. So we work across several different treatment areas at Capri, but we've been lucky enough to work particularly closely with Myeloma Australia and across a number of different studies related to myeloma over the years. So one of these studies we conducted was in 2018, and its goal was to explore the treatment preferences of people living with myeloma and then compare them to the treatment preferences of carers, hematologists, and nurses. Now, when I use the term treatment preferences, I'm referring to just what's most important to an individual when it comes to making decisions about their treatment and how they value different aspects of treatment. So, for example, how the treatment is delivered, whether the person prefers an oral tablet, an injection, or an IV, whether it's delivered at home or in a clinic, how much it costs, what side effects an individual might be willing to take on, and what benefits from treatment are most important to that individual. So the two main findings from this research project were that not all patients value the same treatment features equally, and that there is some misalignment between what patients value and what healthcare providers value. So what this showed us was that shared decision making is especially crucial in myeloma, because patients have different treatment preferences, and your preferences may be different from your healthcare team. Therefore, it's especially important to have open conversations about what's important to you, because it's possible you and your care team could have different ideas about what the best treatment for you looks like. But despite the importance of shared decision making, we found that there's a lack of resources and tools to actually help facilitate these types of conversations. So with this context in mind, we found that there was a need for a tool that gives people living with myeloma the opportunity to identify what their preferences are, and then summarizes this information in a way that's easy to communicate with their healthcare team. So that's exactly what we did. Over the past few years, we've been working with Myeloma Australia and with support from Janssen and Takeda in order to develop this free shared decision-making tool. We've gone through several stages of pilot testing, including interviews with patients and healthcare providers, and we're excited to now be sharing it with the broader myeloma community. In fact, you may have already seen some Facebook posts on Myeloma Australia's page introducing the app. Thanks to Megan for that. Here's a quote from one of the patient partners who piloted the app for us in early days, and her thoughts on why the shared decision-making process is important. I think it's quite powerful and underlines the need for a tool like this. So she said, some patients may feel inhibited about asking dumb questions of their medicos or about asserting their own priorities and may not have even worked out what their priorities are. Shared decision making allows patients to establish their priorities and gives them a voice in the treatment they receive. Okay, so now that I've given a bit of background, I'm gonna jump right into what the app actually looks like and how to use it. Then I'll provide some experiences of people within the myeloma community who've used the app, and then some tips for getting started on using the app if you would like to do so. I'd like to let you know also that all the information I'll cover today is available at choiceapp.com.au. And for those who are here in person, I know this will also be shared with people over the internet, but if you're here in person, you have these flyers on your table, and there's more by the door over there, and they summarize some key information, so don't worry about trying to remember everything. Great, so after you've downloaded the app, you'll be asked to sign up and create a profile. You can do this by connecting with your Facebook account, with your Apple ID if you're an iPhone user, or you can just register manually. No matter what option you choose, we've designed it to be accessible, quick, straightforward. Now you will be asked to enter some information, but I want to assure you that your data is very safe. We adhere to very strict privacy policies at Capri. Your data will not be shared with anyone, and it is stored in Australia in a secure environment, not overseas. The most important part of creating a profile is this question here that will ask you to enter a code word. It says optional, but it's not optional, and that needs to be fixed. When you get to this question, please select MMSDM as your code word. This stands for Multiple Myeloma Shared Decision Making, but it's quite a mouthful to say, so we use MMSDM for short. So once you're on the homepage of the app, you'll see the three main activities that make up the shared decision-making program. This includes a treatment preferences survey, a quality of life survey, and a follow-up survey. I'll give a brief overview of each, starting with the treatment preferences survey. So this exercise is considered the main activity of this shared decision-making program. It takes about 10 minutes to complete, and it uses, the survey itself uses a choice-based methodology called best-worst scaling, which will probably be unfamiliar to most people, but other patients who've used the app have told us that it's easy to get the hang of. After you've completed the survey, you'll receive a real-time, so automatically generated, summary report that will highlight what treatment features are most important to you. This is what the survey itself looks like. You'll be presented with a series of screens, just like this one. Each screen is a different hypothetical treatment profile. And you'll be asked to select which feature you think is the best or most desirable for each profile, and which feature you think is the worst or least desirable. So for this person, for example, you can see that they think the best thing about this treatment is that there's no side effects. The worst thing about this treatment is that it has to be administered by IV at a hospital. Now, another person may answer this question completely differently. There's no right or wrong answers, and that's what makes this sort of exercise so informative. So you'll be asked to answer a number of scenarios like this, but you'll get through them very fast, especially after the first few screens. Some screens may seem similar, but there are small differences between them. And by observing how your answers change across screens, the app on the back end can then use that information to determine what features are most important to you and by how much. As I mentioned, this technique is called best worst scaling, and it's frequently used in preference research, so the type of research that we do at Capri. And it's considered a more reliable way to determine someone's preferences than, for example, a more standard exercise, like rating how important something is to you on a scale from 1 to 10. This is because my 8 out of 10, for example, could be very different to somebody else's 8 out of 10. Someone could also rate, you know, all features as equally important as 9 out of 10, which would be very understandable, especially in the myeloma treatment area, because all parts of treatment are important, of course, but unfortunately, this wouldn't give you as much insightful, practical information that could help with decision making. So best worst scaling, on the other hand, takes advantage of our ability to identify extremes, and will be more similar to the types of trade-offs and tough decisions that we have to make in real life when making treatment decisions. Okay, so when you complete the survey, you'll receive this interactive summary report based on your answers, and it'll group features by their level of importance to you, from higher importance to moderate importance to lower importance. Now, those features grouped in the lower importance category doesn't mean they're not important to you, it just means that they're simply less important relative to other features shown. Beside each feature, there's these little arrows, and if you press them, it will expand to show you what your preferences actually are within each feature. So using the example of mode of administration, we can see that for this person, oral treatment is preferred, and then subcutaneous injections, and then IV. So you can use this information, you can take it to your doctor's office and show it to them directly on the phone if you want, or you also have the ability within the app to email this report to yourself or a family member or anyone you choose, and you can print it off and bring a hard copy if you want as well. And at the end of the presentation, I'll talk a bit more about how you can incorporate this into your appointments. So I do just want to note that this survey is not designed to select a specific treatment for you. Treatment features are hypothetical. They're examples of things that can be associated with myeloma treatments and are designed to help guide a shared discussion with your healthcare team, but are not designed to select a specific treatment. Now, embedded in the survey itself, we have this step-by-step video that walks you through the survey process. I won't play it today as I've already talked you through that process a bit, but I just wanted to let you know that the resource is there. It's embedded within the app, it's on the first few pages of the survey, so you'll have a chance to view it before completing the exercise if you'd like. The next survey is the quality of life survey. This one is very quick and simple. It's a multiple choice survey adapted from the Myeloma Patient Outcome Scale, which is also referred to as MyPOS. The MyPOS questionnaire is commonly used in clinical trials, and sometimes just in routine visits in doctor's offices to assess quality of life issues specific to myeloma. So you may already be familiar with it. As you're completing the questionnaire, you may realize you've answered very similar questions like this in the past. After you've completed the survey, you'll receive a personalized report summarizing your quality of life for different areas of wellness. This is just a screenshot of what one of the survey pages looks like. And this is an example of the personalized report. So as you can see, it rates, gives you a score for different areas of wellness, and then one overall score out of 100. Just like the treatment preferences survey, you can print or email this information if you choose. But what is especially useful is that old reports are stored within the app, so you can come back and complete this questionnaire as many times as you'd like throughout your treatment pathway, which will allow you and your healthcare team, if you choose to share the information, to allow you to track changes in quality of life over time. And you'll notice that when completing the survey, a number of questions ask you about your wellness in the last week specifically. So understandably, your quality of life and your wellness could be different some weeks compared to other weeks, and this can allow you to track that. Lastly, is the follow-up survey. So once you've completed the other activities on the app and had a consultation with your healthcare team, we would really appreciate it if you could come back and complete the short follow-up survey. We just want to know about your experiences using the app. For example, how accessible it was, whether you shared this information with your healthcare provider, and if so, what was that experience like? The goal is just for us to evaluate the program as it's still in its early stages and so that we can keep improving it for other people living with myeloma. I thought it may be helpful as a part of this presentation to hear from people within the myeloma community about their perspectives on Choice App and shared decision making in general. This first video is of Kath Rutherford, who is someone who is involved in piloting the app. She's in her early 70s and was diagnosed with myeloma a few years ago. This is just a short snippet, but on the website, you can watch the full video if you'd like.
I think shared decision making is important because it allows the medico to have an insight into the patient's experience, the patient's priorities, and the patient's perspectives. Often medicos' perspective is necessarily one of how this treatment works with the population, how it's distributed, how generally, you know, what percentage might respond in various ways. Whereas an individual is more concerned, obviously, about the treatment's effect on them. And it's very important for the medico to see that both in terms of psychology, emotion, and as well as the general medical response to treatment. I quite enjoyed using the Choice app because it was a very clear app, very easy to use, very appealing to use. I think being able to answer questions and then find a summary at the end that is a visual representation of what is important to you. So you might think you know what's important to you, but until you answer all those questions, you don't actually see them presented objectively or numerically. And I found it interesting just to see how important survival was to me after answering all of those questions. Survival was clearly the most important factor for me, rather than side effects. All of these sorts of sources of information and analysis are really important when you've got a serious diagnosis, a serious condition. And I think it's important because it does show you what's important to you, how you've assessed different factors, different aspects of your condition.
So this next video is of Haley Beer, who's a specialist myeloma nurse. Some of you may know her. She is based in Melbourne, and she has been working closely with Capri since the beginning to help develop this app. She's the manager of programs and services at Myeloma Australia.
I was first introduced to the concept of Choice App when Capri posed the idea to us at Myeloma Australia, and we thought such a wonderful idea and concept and something that can really, really help the people in the myeloma community. I think it's a wonderful tool for healthcare professionals to use in the clinics. Most of the time there's a limited time frame that we have when we're seeing patients and their family members in the clinics, usually only around 15 minutes. And there's often a lot of information to get out in that time. So having choice app forms being filled in prior to the appointment not only helps the person and the family member organise their thoughts and their priorities for the meeting, it helps the doctor also then understand what the priorities are and where they should focus their time. I think from the pilot, one of the most important takeaways we found from patients utilising the Choice app was that it really highlighted that shared decision making is so important and really needs to be placed in the forefront of our minds when we're caring for people living with myeloma. And it also reaffirmed that it's really important that we empower our community with information and tools and opportunities to learn more about the disease, because sometimes you just don't know what you don't know and what is important to ask. And I think having the Choice app available to utilise before seeing the doctor will really help maximise the benefit of having a treating team caring for you.
So you can check out more stakeholder videos if you want of other people within the myeloma community and their perspectives. So to quickly summarize, Choice App can help you identify and reflect on your personal treatment priorities, centralize and prioritize your questions to prepare in advance of appointments, and then communicate this information to your healthcare team using the personalized summary report, and lastly, track changes in both your preferences and quality of life over time throughout your treatment pathway by accessing old reports on the homepage menu. Anyone living with multiple myeloma can use Choice App, but our pilot phases showed that it's particularly beneficial for people who are recently diagnosed, undergoing a change in treatment, or looking to build confidence in clinical interactions with their healthcare team. In addition to potential benefits for you and your family, it also has the potential to benefit the community as a whole. So we'll be analyzing patients' treatment preferences all together using de-identified data, of course, so none of your personal information will be connected to the data set. But by being able to look at preferences across the community, we can improve understanding about what is important to people living with myeloma on a community level, and then use this information to advocate for access to treatments that better align with patient values. Additionally, we can see how things like location, age, or employment status may impact preferences to identify different areas of need within the myeloma community. And that's the reason why we ask you to provide some information such as your age, location, and employment status so that it can be used in this way. If you're interested in checking out the program, we really encourage you to do so. It can be downloaded on both iPhone or Android devices. But because it's a fairly new app, it doesn't always show up right away in the App Store when you type in its name, so we do encourage you to use this direct link. And if you're here in person, the QR code will take you to that same download page. It's just a little example of how to use the QR code. I think a lot of us got quite familiar with QR codes in the midst of the pandemic, needing to check into places, but in case you need a refresher, just open up the camera app on your phone. Now, if you have any questions or you need any assistance, please don't hesitate to contact me. My contact information is at the bottom of the flyer, and I'll get back to you as soon as possible if you reach out to me. And I'll also be hanging around once the workshop closes today, so I'm more than happy to answer any questions or even help you download the app, set up a profile if that's something that would be useful for you. Well, thank you so much for listening today. It's such an honor to get to connect with the myeloma community in person. It's been so great to work with the myeloma community in the development of this app. As I said earlier, at Capri, we work across a number of different treatment areas, but we often say in our office that the myeloma community is truly special, that patients and carers are so passionate and engaged and so generously willing to participate in research. So it's a true pleasure to get to see you and connect with you today. And I do hope that this tool will be useful and ideally help improve some of your clinical experiences. Yeah, any questions?
I've got one here too for you.
Oh, sorry. I've just been asked, is there any help available to those of us who have less ability to navigate this web easily, app easily, rather?
Yes, definitely. So that contact information, we're very happy to have a phone call with you or even a video call if that's easier. And as I said, I'm very happy to provide some in-person assistance here today.
Thank you.
I was just wondering how the fraternity of haematologists have accepted this, or have they been made aware and gone to sessions like this? And, you know, if somebody turns up with somewhere, they're going to go, oh, what's this newfangled thing? Or have they been told about it and they're on board?
Yeah, it's a great question. So through our pilot phases, the hematologists we work with, who of course was a small sample compared to the overall community of hematologists, they were very on board. But our next step now is to disseminate this information to healthcare providers. We started with patients, as you're the center of everything, but hematologists next will be publishing some articles in different hematology platforms to get some information out. And I think our lovely Myeloma Australia nurses will be sharing some information as well. Just on that note, also on the website, there is a specific page for information for healthcare professionals. And if your healthcare professionals have any questions, it might be a good place to direct them to, and we're happy to get in contact with them. But yes, ideally, as we get more information out, they will be hopefully anticipating it and aware of it in the coming months.
Thank you so much, Maya. And if you have any more questions as well, if you were to do a report, there's a phone number that you can reach the Capri group, but you can also ring the Myeloma Australia nurses, and we can talk through maybe approaching that if you were going to bring that to the an appointment for the first time. So we always love when patient remains the centre of focus, and haematologists like that as well. They like to know what direction to go in. We're getting into a landscape now where there are more and more treatment options, so having direction from you is really important and hopefully well received. So thank you so much, Maya, today. That was really lovely. This is the best chocolate. That's great. And I'll hand over to Leish.
Hello, everyone. I cannot tell you, you probably have guessed from, because the smile has not left my face all day, how amazing it is to see our incredible South Australian community all in one room and just selling out this event, essentially. I think it says a lot about us as a community. I'm really proud to be a part of it, even though I know everyone's choice would be to not actually be a part of this community. But I think the way that you come together, you know, try to understand and take charge of your disease is really incredible. And yeah, I'm just very proud to be in this room today. And I think the best comment I've had from an audience member today at lunch was, God, I hope the haematologists are prepared for their clinics to run late, because everyone's going to be at them with more questions than they've ever had before. So we might need to run upstairs and give them all a heads up. So it is my very great pleasure to introduce our final speaker of the day. And I do know I had, again, several members of the community say to me, oh, yes, of course we're coming. My doctor is speaking. I have to support Dr. Cindy Lee. So I'm sure she's going to get a big warm welcome when she steps onto the stage. But Associate Professor Cindy Lee trained as a haematologist in Perth and then furthered her studies in the UK on a clinical fellowship awarded by the European Group for Bone and Marrow Transplantation. She returned to Australia in 2009 and was appointed as a clinical laboratory haematologist at the Royal Adelaide and Queen Elizabeth's hospitals. Cindy treats all blood disorders and has particular expertise in blood cancers such as lymphoma and leukemias, but has a particular clinical focus on myeloma and amyloidosis. Her leadership is recognised by the Medical and Scientific Advisory Group for Myeloma Australia and the Centre for International Blood and Bone and Marrow Transplant Registry. I knew I was going to stuff that up. Cindy's well known for her passion and dedication to her patients to enable them to feel empowered about their conditions and to make informed decisions about their health. And Cindy is also happy to consult in English and Mandarin. So in case you didn't already get it, she's a very, very smart lady. Thank you very much, Cindy.
Thanks, Alicia. That was a good bio, but I think might be a bit out of date, but that's all right. That's right. It's great to see such a great turnout, and I can see many familiar faces actually in the audience. My patients, their family, some I don't know, but it's great. I think obviously it speaks about the community within South Australia. It's very strong, the network, so fantastic. Thanks all for coming. So thanks to Alicia, Joel Gardner, and organisers for the invitation to speak today. It's my privilege, considering the pool of talent you've got in the room upstairs. I think you guys might have seen the who's who in Myeloma upstairs, but yet Alicia invited me, so thank you. So my job today is to share with you the exciting but somewhat confusing range of therapies in myeloma we've got ahead of us. I think as hematologists, we struggle to keep up to date, so I don't know about you guys, but it seems like every month something else comes along, so it's kind of trying to keep your attention in terms of what are we using now? What does it mean for us in Australia? So lots to learn. So from Professor Han Kwok's talk this morning, she's very dynamic, fantastic. I think she's given you a lot of information about the basics of biology of myeloma. So what I'm gonna do is revisit the role of the immune system in a fight against myeloma. And then I'll focus on the immune therapies, specifically on CAR-T that everyone's heard so much about. And in every clinic I do, without the Choice app, I hear about what's CAR-T, when am I getting it? So I think even without the Choice app, we already know that CAR-T is one of the topics that we're going to be focusing on in the months ahead. I'm going to talk so about bispecific antibodies, which we've actually got here in trials, not as well known as CAR-T, but certainly a very important immune therapy out there as well. And I'll talk about antibody drug conjugates and then finish with the trials that we've got in South Australia. We've got quite a few. So in 2023, we still don't know what actually causes myeloma. We know it's not infectious, we know it's not preventable. But from research, we've got much better understanding of its biology. We recognise the bone marrow environment is important. We know there's actually cytokines or chemicals involved when progression happens. And we know there's a link between the immune system and cancer. So based on this knowledge, there's been strategies really undertaken to retrain the immune system to kill myeloma, so what we call immune therapy. So I don't know about you, but immunology, I think in med school for me, has always been one of the complicated subjects. My eyes always glaze over when the immunology lecture comes on, but it's obviously very important these days, so I think I'm kind of retraining myself in immunology as well, even though I'm a hematologist. So I think the simplest way of thinking about the immune system is that the different cells are involved. So we've got B cells, which are good cells to fight infections, and we've got T cells, so you can see there's different types of T cells. We don't have a pointer, do we?
No.
No, okay, that's right. No, oh, you can. Thanks, Megan. That's right, you can run. No, it's fine. So there's different types of T cells out there, and all of them got their own roles. So myeloma, as Hung would have told you, is a type of B cell which went wrong. So it's a B cell, produced antibodies, but it went wrong because there's too many of it that's been made. So on the B cell, on myeloma cells, it's got lots of proteins on it. So it's got a coating and lots of proteins in it. And basically, we're trying to target these proteins to try to kill this myeloma cell. So it's, I think, what people have described as a lock and a key concept. You need a specific lock if you want to open, you need a specific key if you want to open your car door. You can't just go to someone's car and use your key to try to open it. So it's actually very precise. So I guess it's good in a way because we're trying to design a precise therapy to try to hone in and kill the myeloma cells and not and have less collateral damage. I don't have a pointer, but you can see in the middle there, there's the myeloma cells, so that's the B cells. And on it, you can see those green shapes. So basically, those are the... Thanks, Megan. Yeah. So those are the proteins that we're trying to target. So these proteins are what's going to be recognized by the different immune drugs. So the best ones that we want to target are the ones that are just on myeloma cells and not on the normal cells, because we just want to kill the bad cells, not the good cells. So hopefully we'll get less what we call off-target toxicities. So I think Angie touched on what we've got here already on PBS. So we've got the monoclonal antibodies. So we've got elotuzumab. We've got, what else have we got? Daratumumab. We've got, not quite here yet, but we've got antibody drug conjugates like belantamab down the bottom there. And of course, we've got CAR T up in the top left corner there. So BCMA, actually, I can't go back, can I? I won't click it, okay. So those green things that Megan was trying to point to you just then are all basically BCMA. So they're a protein that at the moment is probably the most well-studied. Yeah, those are the ones here. The most well-studied, and when we talk about immune therapy myeloma, that's actually been the one that's been most well-known. So I can now go forward. Yep, thank you, yeah. So BCMA, what is it? It's basically B-cell maturation antigens. So lots of big names, so we try to abbreviate everything. Otherwise, in a clinic, you just have lots of big terms, which overwhelms people. So BCMA, hopefully, is something that you hear a lot more out of, but it kind of makes a bit more sense. So it's a protein that's expressed specifically on the plasma cells, and what it does is supports antibody production. It's not expressed in other tissues, so it's seen as someone's myeloma progresses. So because of this, we can actually use it as a target. So it's actually really good because it's in myeloma cells. But there's also other targets that are now a lot more work done, because we know that not everybody respond to specifically the BCMA targeting agents. So there's also work looking at other targets, which are GPRC5D, FCHR5, and SLAMF7. All of these have got long names, so I wouldn't actually bore you with the details because you wouldn't want to know about it anyway. Right, yeah. So just concentrating on the BCMA, because this is the most well-studied target. So it's used in antibody-drug conjugate, so belantamab. I know some of you in the room has had belantamab on trials. So it's specifically targeting BCMA, belantamab. It's also been looked at using, being used in CAR-T. So the two well-knowns are Ardacell and Siltacell, different company, so they've got different names. And there's also the bispecific antibodies. I guess at the moment, the most well-known to us is probably teclistamab. So they are all effective, but I think we still have a lot to learn about how do we use them, how do we sequence them, when do we use them, how do we improve the response, and how do we make people last longer in terms of remission as well with this. So still lots to learn out there, and I think that's why there's still a lot of trials that are being done to kind of really look at all these drugs. So myeloma therapy in Australia has come a long way. We know that in the last 15 years in particular, so I came back to Australia from the UK in 2009, and then since then, there's been so many changes. It's certainly hard to keep up, but I think that's our job, to kind of try to get to a cure if we can. So we've gone from, when I came back, we were using thalidomide, so CTD. We were using it with combination with chemo. We were then using melphalan, prednisolone, and then we went to VRD, so Velcade, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone, which is only available up front 3 years ago, so it's actually not that long. So you can imagine that there's been a long period we had nothing, and then all of a sudden we have got all these drugs. We also have, obviously, lenalidomide in maintenance. In relapse setting, we've got carfilzomib, we've got pomalidomide, we've got elotuzumab, we've got daratumumab, and now we've got a lot of trials looking at the immune therapies down the bottom there. So we've come a long way, but I think especially in Australia, we do lag behind globally. Our global colleagues were a bit far away, but I think especially our jurisdiction is a bit different as well. We do have access to some of these drugs, but we don't have easy access to them outside clinical trials. So that kind of brings us to, I think, what you guys want to hear about, CAR-T. So what's CAR-T? So CAR-T stands for chimeric antigen receptor T-cell therapy. We know that immune therapy, basically what it's meant to do is change some of the body's T-cells to try to improve the body's ability to fight cancer. So it's a pretty complex process. So there's actually quite a few steps involved. So first of all, you have to get the cells from the person, and then you have to make the cells. And often this would take time, so it would take up to 6 weeks. And during this time, you might have to treat your patient or people who are undergoing treatment, because obviously myeloma might not stay still. So often it involves what we use, what we call bridging therapy, so treatment to try to bridge the gap between cells being made to when you're collecting, from when you collect them to when they're made. And then usually we then prepare the immune system to accept the T cells, and then you reinfuse the CAR T cells back. So how does that actually work? So T cells is a type of white cells, is a part of the immune system. So they function to identify abnormal changes in the cell and destroy that cell. So it's a bit like a superhero that comes along, kill the bad cells. And what CAR T is basically the specially treated T cells. So what they've done to this is that they've re-engineered them in the lab to change the property. So they stick a vector into the cell itself, and then basically it then makes the cell recognize and destroy myeloma cells. So essentially what you're trying to do is you're modifying them to try to prime the T cells, return them, and try to then target them against the myeloma cells. So the nuts and bolts of CAR T cells. So as I told you, first of all, you need to collect the cells. So that's done in the hospital in a process called leukapheresis. Leuko just means white cells. So essentially you're trying to take the white cells from the person, and then you separate it in the lab. So you get T cells, and then you basically then make them in the lab into CAR T cells. And after you've made them or engineered them, they now have got CARs on their surface. You can then reinfuse them, and hopefully these T cells, which then go to where they need to and kill the myeloma cells by sticking onto the bad cells. Does that make sense so far? Yep. Okay. Just slow me down if I'm talking too fast, because I do have a tendency to just talk fast, as I think my patients would know. So we know we hear so much about it because it does work. It works in a lot of people. It doesn't work in everybody, but it works in a good fraction of people. So we see response rate up to 75% and sometimes even higher. And I think the good thing about it is at the moment it's been said to be one and done. So it means that you give the CAR T and then that's it. And hopefully you be fine. And I think for the people who are in this room who I've treated for years, we try to keep people in therapy, and that's always difficult because obviously therapy's got side effects, it makes them tired, they come in to see me often, which they don't want to do, they'd rather go off and have a cruise somewhere. So I think it's all that's hopefully if you give someone something and they can actually have a period without seeing me, I think I'm sure they all love that. They won't want to come and say hello, they will just see me in years' time. So that's really good. I think that's what we want to try to get to. Steroids is a big thing as well. I think a lot of people hate steroids. Steroids makes you not sleep. It makes you put on weight, and it makes you go very grumpy. Your moods go up and down, and the spouse of the people on steroids always says, oh, can you please do something about steroids? They're a different person. And then I can kind of, maybe we should. So I think CAR-T without the steroids is good, and certainly it does work for people who've been through quite a few different lines of treatment. But of course, we can't have too much of a good thing. We know there's always risks and there's always challenges involved. So CAR-T, even though it's great, there's still a lot of problems that I think we do have to overcome. So what are some of this? So risk, I suppose, is probably what we'll go through first. So risks are to do with the treatment itself. So you can have it at the early stage, so from the beginning when you give the CAR-T back to someone and to about a month after. And then you've got the longer term effects. So the immediate things you see are what we call cytokine release syndrome, which I'll go into the next slide. You've got neurotoxicity, so people can get quite delirious. They might not be able to speak. They might not be able to write. They can actually be have seizures. So there are serious side effects associated with CAR-T, which I don't think is well
talked about. So a lot of people just don't see all that because it's all done in hospital, not well reported. And there's also prolonged cytopenia, so reduced blood counts. That obviously means transfusions, infections. So there are issues. And longer term, months to years, we do see secondary cancers. We do see fatigue, memory issues, chemo brain. I think it's a very common thing that a lot of people talk about. I think this memory issues with CAR-T is not as well described, but something that people are noticing as we use more and more CAR-T. There's infections because you're using the T cells. You're kind of pushing them to do something else, so they're not fighting infections. So we are seeing more infections as well. And of course, we've got the longer term blood counts being low as well. So transfusions, infections. So I promise I'll talk about cytokine release syndrome because I guess that is a big thing that we do recognize and we do bring people into hospitals. So cytokine release syndrome or CRS, so what is it? Cytokines are chemicals. So these are part of our immune system. And what they do is they help to control the growth and activity of immune cells. So when the immune system is stimulated by CAR-T, the immune system can respond very aggressively. So they're very exaggerated, the response. And so lots of different things can happen. And basically the way that we grade them is we based it on how severe it is. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 being the most severe. So basically what happened is the body released too many cytokines. And then you can get different symptoms, and all these symptoms can affect different organs at the same time. So someone can actually get quite sick. So you can see it can affect the brain, the lungs, the liver. So every part of the body can be affected. And what you do about it depends on what the person is going through, so what needs are. Worst case scenario, they go to intensive care. Not so bad, they might need steroids to suppress inflammation, or they use specific drugs called tocilizumab to kind of suppress specific cytokines. So I've told you there's been lots of trials out there, and globally, internationally, there are lots of trials. So they all kind of, you hear about all these names, Karma, Cartitude, so all basically just different different drugs, different CAR-T product used at different times of someone's myeloma. So there's Karma 3, 2, 4, 9, and then there's the product called Cilta-Cel, which is used in Cartitude. There's 2, 4, 5, and 6, and at the moment they're also trying to combine CAR-T with other things as well. So we're going to see combination trials coming. Australia, even though we lag behind our colleagues in the States, in Europe, we do have some. We don't have a lot, but we have some. So for the newly diagnosed people, we have currently we've got Cartitude 5, which I think Hung mentioned in a talk this morning. We are looking at Cartitude 6. Adelaide, we are getting Cartitude 6 as well, so it's starting, but not quite sure exactly when yet. And there's also Karma 9, and we've also completed a CAR-T trial in Adelaide and Australia, which is Cartitude 4, which was actually reported not long ago. So it was reported at ASCO and also EHA, so the big European meetings that was in the last couple of months. And I'm sure there's more that will be reported in America at the big ASH meeting. So you could see that the reason why people are so excited about it is that it is effective. So that's the difference between the line in teal, is that teal color? Versus the red, which is the standard of care, which the standard of care in this trial was using a combination of either daratumumab, pomalidomide, and dex, or pomalidomide, Velcade, and dex. So I guess what they call standard of care because they've been used for a while. So you can see the difference between the two lines here, and it's what they call progression-free survival. I think some of you might be unfamiliar with the term progression-free survival, but they mention it a lot. It basically refers to the time when someone got randomized on the trial to the treatment, so whichever group, to when your disease progresses or when you die. So that's what they call progression-free survival. So in this trial, they randomized or they enrolled 419 patients, and they showed that the people in the CAR-T trial have an earlier and deeper complete response compared to the people who have standard of care treatment and reduced the chance of progression or death compared to the standard of care. But of course, along with risk, we also see challenges with any treatment. And there's certainly challenges that we're now seeing about CAR-T as well. So financial toxicity is a huge thing. It's expensive. It's hard to know exactly how much it costs, but I think the ballpark figure we're hearing about is about $500,000. So if it's done in certain countries, so it's expensive. So it's a huge problem. Obviously, it's going to be a difficult thing in terms of the budget. But the other big problem is also manufacturing ability. So I don't know whether you guys heard in the news. So this is Peter Mac. Peter Mac is Melbourne-based. So there's been news about a new expanded facility at Peter Mac in Melbourne that was opened by the Federal Health Minister Mark Butler in July, which basically promised to make up to 2,000 patient doses of CAR T, and this would be kind of a 400% increase, depends on what the previous capacity is. It's currently under construction, is due to be open later this year, so potentially we'll have the ability to supply the whole of Australia, which will be wonderful, and other countries as well. So exciting news. So like all trials, we know that trials doesn't represent the real world. We have people on trial, but we also have a lot of people don't go on trials. We like to treat people on trials, but then the reality is not everyone is going to be eligible. Not everyone is going to want to be on trials. There's always a choice there. And we know that trials are great because they bring in new information, but it doesn't represent the real world. The real world, when you get information and you try to then practice it, it often there's difference. And the difference that we've seen, the complicating issues that we've seen is that there are obviously costs. There's access, so we don't have slots when we want to. How do you select the patient? So if I've got a patient in a room, how do I select who I offer the CAR T to if you give me one slot? How do you kind of say, oh, I'm going to give Mr. So-and-so this and not so-and-so? So I think that's still a lot that we need to work out when we do get CAR T. How do we choose who do we do it for? So lots of things to think about. Some people have got very aggressive myeloma, so you do need to also give them treatment to stabilize the myeloma while the cells are being made. And at the moment, I think the thing that we're also seeing is that CAR T may not last forever. So there's also the concern about durability. So do we need to give maintenance doses of CAR T? So I think at the moment, there's still a lot of strategies that are being looked at as to how to optimize CAR T. So this is just a bit of a picture in terms of what may happen in the real world after you've got trials results. So you can see that the CAR T, so in the trial, everything goes to plan because you've got limited patients, you've got slots guaranteed, but in the real world, things happened. Your CAR T may take a lot longer to be made, and then the problem is then you have to stabilize your patient during this time when there are delays. So can the myeloma stay stable during the time that you're kind of waiting for the CAR T to be ready, to be given? And of course, people do run into problems and they may require hospitalization for longer. So why does CAR T not always work? So myeloma might be too aggressive. There are some people that myeloma just takes off as soon as you take them off treatment. So sometimes you just don't have the time. So sometimes myeloma can progress before you can reinfuse the CAR T. CAR T are also being used at the moment quite late. So the problem with that is that the patient's immune system is better, is kind of really beaten up. So the CAR T, the T cells that you try to collect may not be very effective. The CAR T cells may not hang around long enough to do their job. And the myeloma cells sometimes can also get smart. They lose the target. They find ways around drugs, as we know they do. So what can we do? So what does the future look like? So can CARs fly? Maybe. At the moment, there's certainly different generations of CAR T that's been looked at. So they've gone from first generation, second, third, fourth generation. So you can see that each step, something's been modified. So the fourth generation, third generation have got things modified to it to make the CAR last longer. We know that we're also looking at maybe trying to get the T cells earlier before someone has had too many treatment. Maybe getting T cells from healthy donors, maybe getting it off the shelf, so made it someone else. Using other targets, so don't use the same target because the target sometimes obviously the myeloma gets smart, shed the target or just find ways around it. So use other targets. And also I guess we need to optimize manufacturing. So I guess like the strategy with Peter Mac, that's a great move. So CAR T is, am I going all right with time, Megan? Timing wise is great, yeah. Okay, so CAR T is good, but of course not accessible. Are there options? Yes, there are. I guess there are options with immune therapy such as NEC antibodies. There's antibody drug conjugates that we mentioned before about belantamab. There's also the bispecific antibodies. So bispecific antibodies are essentially off-the-shelf treatment. So it's that, so in the far corner, you can see it's that antibody, the Y-shaped thing there. So what it is basically got two arms. You can imagine it's like a person. We've got two arms. So one arm kind of grabs hold onto the myeloma. One arm gets onto the T cells, and he kind of bring the T cells to the myeloma cells and tell the T cells to kill the myeloma cells. So I guess the antibody can do the killing, and you're trying to get the T cells to kind of try to go to where the disease actually is. So I guess it's kind of relying on different ways of killing the myeloma, so in a different way to CAR T. We know that there are different trials out there at the moment. So they are using BCMA as a target, but they're also using other other antigen markers, so GPRC5D, FCRH5, and they've all shown good safety profiles. But because the immune therapies have can all cause CRS as well, at the moment it's said that the severe ones, so the grade 3, are less than CAR T, so maybe it's a bit safer, but the risk is still out there, so we still need to observe some people. We do need to bring them to the hospitals to observe them for the first two doses. The trouble with bispecific antibodies is that they're frequent, so they can be weekly or fortnightly, which is currently what the schedules of all these therapies are. They are intravenous, so into the blood, or the injections, so they're pretty intense. And at the moment, the way that you've been used is that they keep using them until someone loses response to it. So it's actually a long time, potentially, that you might be on it. But it certainly works. So we're seeing the response up to 80%, which is not bad comparing to CAR T, so it's equivalent. So this is a busy slide. So this is kind of an overview of the trials that's been done on bispecific antibodies. So you can see there's different targets. So the BCMA, the first four, and then you've got the last two, which are different targets. So teclistamab is one that we've used in Australia. Cevostamab we've used in Australia. And we've got elranatamab and the other ones that are also coming as well. So they all work, and you can see that the response is also quite good with the complete response in sometimes up to 30%, 40% of people. So it's good. But certainly, there's also the risk of CRS as well that you can see down the bottom. So the summary of bispecific antibodies, that there are several out there. We know that we don't know enough about it at the moment. We don't know enough in terms of how long they may last for, what the maximum response is. So there's currently also trials to try to look at combining them with other drugs as well, other agents as well. So watch this space. Maybe in 5 years' time, we might have both in Australia, and then the dilemma will be, which one do we choose? So I think there's a lot of debate out there in terms of, when you do get a drug like that, if the cost is kind of expensive anyway, which one do you actually go for? Which one do you recommend to the patient? So there's different factors that people consider: convenience, the side effects, obviously, hospitalization, and what the ongoing future looks like for that therapy. So I'll just briefly touch on belantamab, because that is something that we have been engaged in terms of trials. So belantamab is also antibody, so use a different mechanism. So it's an intravenous antibody which targets BCMA, and the way that they use it is to combine it with a drug, so antibody drug conjugate. So essentially is the thing at the bottom there. So you've got the myeloma cells, which is in orange. Thank you, Megan. And you've got the triangular thing on the surface, which is the BCMA. So belantamab is the thing, the antibody that has got the linker with the toxin attached to it. So basically what you're trying to do is antibody sticks to your myeloma cells because it recognizes the target, and it's hand-delivering the toxins on its back and dumping into the myeloma cells, so killing it that way as well. So it kills it by the antibody, and it kills it by the toxins. So it's a... Thank you for standing there. So it's an extra mechanism. So it works. It doesn't work in everybody, but it certainly worked. And I guess the trials using belantamab was a bit earlier. So at that time, we don't really have CAR T bispecific. So certainly when it came along and it was used, it certainly benefited a fair few of my patients. But it's not 100% specific for myeloma cells at the moment, unfortunately. So it has got off-target toxicities. So it's got eye issues. So that's why I think that's also the other side that we consider. So the people that can't read, the people that can't drive, and those are the things that does impact quality of life. So I think all these drugs are great, but then of course you need to consider. Sorry, my children out there. You want to see Alex? Alex. Oh, no. So this is Alex. Is it hello, table? Just a hello and you're going to get out. Okay, just a hello, Alex. Is it hello? Alex, hello.
Hello.
And this is Jelly, my son. Okay, now you two need to get out. David's out there. That's my husband. Sorry, I hope you're not recording this. sorry, that was not planned. They're going to turn up. Apologies. So let's get back to serious stuff. we're just talking about the trials, right? So belantamab. It was a drug that does work to the extent that it got accelerated FDA approval in August 2020, so 3 years ago, based on DREAM 2. But then in 2022, when they got results from the DREAM 3 study, unfortunately, it wasn't proven to be superior, which is what the company was trying to do. So they actually voluntarily withdraw the approval from the FDA at that time. So it's off the market at the moment. But there's still a number of trials ongoing, DREAM 14, DREAM 7, DREAM 8, that might still bring belantamab back, but I think at the moment it's kind of still a bit unclear where it fits. So just one slide on this new drug called Cereblon E3 ligase modulator, so CELMoD. It's an oral drug. It's the next generation immune drugs. So a lot of you in the audience would have been on thalidomide, lenalidomide, pomalidomide. So CELMoDs are the next generation, and basically, I guess you think of it as a new, improved pomalidomide or lenalidomide, more potent and hopefully have a better side effect profile. At the moment, they're being studied. So this is also a busy slide looking at all the immunotherapies out there. So at the top, we've got belantamab, followed by the CAR T, bispecific, and the CELMoDs at the bottom. So lots of things, busy space at the moment for us to kind of learn about what to do. So let's bring it back home, South Australia. So Adelaide, what have we got? We've got trials. We might not have as many as Victoria or New South Wales because our population is smaller, but we're trying. So currently, for the new patients, the new one that comes along newly diagnosed, we've got CARTITUDE 4, which is CAR T cells coming, maybe early next year. We've got a combination of the CELMoD, so iberdomide with Dara and Dex. We've got the ALG selinexor lenalidomide maintenance. We've got different maintenance post stem cell transplant, and we've got a couple of other trials as well, Australian based. For the relapse patients, very busy at the moment. So we've got a lot of bispecific antibodies at the moment, mostly at the Royal Adelaide, because lots of these bispecific antibodies require hospitalization, so that's where we need to do them. So you can see that there's lots out there, so very busy at the moment. But it's very exciting. We've got belantamab, we've got CELMoDs, and we've also got monoclonal antibodies, using different monoclonal antibodies to Dara. So the future is great, it's bright. So I think we've made lots of progress in the decades of research. We've got lots of new drugs which translate into better outcome for our patients, better survival. There are multiple active ones, well-tolerated, they're now a lot in trials, some are in the market. But the current problem is how do we optimize when we use them? How do we use them? So I guess that's where the trials are at the moment, to learn about how do we really use them when. So certainly we've come a long way for myeloma. So I said 15 years, we've done obviously lots of changes. We're seeing immunotherapies making their way now. So we've gone from just steroids back in the 1960s and then transplants, antibodies, and now we've got immunotherapy. So lots and lots of work been done, which is wonderful. So this is just a cartoon, I think, from the recent European meeting that they put up there. myeloma cells is the one up there. So I think with that, I've come to the end of my talk. So I want to acknowledge Myeloma Australia for the good work they've done for our patients. I think Mark Henderson has spoken a lot about that this morning. Thank you all for coming along. Thank you to everyone that's involved in trials and research to really improve our fight against myeloma. So it's great to see so many of you here. But lastly, I want to thank Roy and Marilyn, who are sitting right at the back there. I know this is their 51st wedding anniversary, which is today. So thank you. Thank you for coming along, giving up a special day to share it with us. And thank you all. Happy to take questions.
Hi, Cindy. How are you?
Hi, good, thanks.
Just one question. You mentioned before that it's possible to collect our T cells whilst you're still quite healthy. Is that something that's on offer? Is that something that we can do? Because, I mean, I'd feel that that would be...
That'd be great if we could do it.
Not wanting to get a CAR T cell...
Let's cook up some... Yeah, that's right. I think that's certainly where we're looking at. We don't know whether that will be a reality at the moment, but I think that's kind of one of the things that people are kind of going, we're collecting cells for stem cell transplant anyway, so why don't you just go and collect cells for potentially CAR T? I think at the moment, the stem cell storage is an issue. We don't have enough space. So I don't think it's quite a reality for us as yet until the stem cell storage facility can improve or expand enough for us to kind of look at that for patients. Have you? Okay, we'll call you up then, John. I'll mention that. Thank you for that.
Any more questions? I think over here. And then one here. We'll go one, two. One here, and then two. Sorry. Oh, no, Tasha's there.
I'll go. I've got the microphone, so I'll talk. So most of the trials are happening at the RA.
Yep.
So for people being treated in other facilities, do they have equal access to the RA trials?
I think, yes, they do, because I and the myeloma group, so at the RA we're active, we've got a myeloma core group, so I think Angie spoke, so she's one of the myeloma physicians. We've got Naomi Horvath, I'm sure many of you would know, we've got Akash. So we work together, we run an MDT, and we talk about trials update, and that is put in a PowerPoint format that we forwarded to people that treats myeloma. I think sometimes the problem is that people don't know about these trials, and it's up to the doctor who's looking after them to tell them that there's a trial. So I guess it kind of sometimes relies on the patient asking the doctor they're seeing, could be private, hey, is there any trial for me? That question, because that person might not have thought about, hey, maybe there's another treatment I need to consider for my patients. We certainly try to, when there's a new trial that starts, I send it out to all the hematologists that treats myeloma, but then it's up to them as to whether they tell people about it. But yes, we do have access to it, and then I see people referred, and then we just then try to go through the screening and put them on if they are eligible. This question here, yeah.
Okay. I don't think I've missed anything. I nodded off for a minute, but anyway. Yeah. I'm currently on a Bellicardi trial,
yep,
at the RA. I'm just wondering when I relapse or if I relapse. CAR T cell, to me now, seems like it's probably a backward step. Can you envisage something going forward for the future? My haematologist said, let's just wait and see until you do relapse. And he's very confident there'll be better stuff. What's your feeling on that?
Yeah, that's right. So I think CAR T at the moment, I don't know where we really stand in terms of CAR T commercial. I think at the moment we are using CAR T mainly in trials because of the costs linked with it. But there are bispecific antibodies. So I think if it's appropriate and a trial using bispecific antibodies, they're not bad. So they're not bad alternative to CAR T in terms of the response. But obviously it's more onerous because of the schedule. But it works. I've got people on it that's gone to complete remission as well. So I think CAR T is great, but it may be further away because of the problems we talked about. But there's other alternatives. So I think for you, it may be a bispecific, and you're the Royal Adelaide, which is where we do trials. So yeah.
Hi, Cindy.
Hello.
A question I've been meaning to ask you, but when we meet, it's always you've got another three people waiting out in the room.
I know. I'm sorry. The choice even worse right now.
The question I wanted to ask, and probably relates to everybody in this room, is that myeloma seems to occur in your later years, like in the 60s and 70s. Mm. And I'm just wondering, I've been having blood tests, general blood tests, since I was 60 years old, but they never picked up my paraprotein. And I'm just wondering why doctors, when they do a blood test, don't actually screen for things like paraprotein to see if they can nip it in the bud.
Great question. Thanks, Fiestas. I think the issue with myeloma is that we know myeloma comes in all shapes and form. So myeloma is something that up until now we don't treat until someone has got symptoms. When we talk about the criteria now as to when you treat. So I think that the issue is that, yep, you've had blood tests, but the problem is that you might not have any symptoms to make the doctor kind of think about myeloma. If someone comes along with anemia or symptoms that tells you that someone might have myeloma, like back pain, then it makes the doctor then look at the blood test and see, hey, what's abnormal about it? What tests I then need to do based on the results? So I guess it kind of depends on the context that those blood tests are being looked at. If they're just routine blood tests, you go into a GP for cholesterol check. That where the myeloma protein sits is the liver function. And if unless you look carefully at it, it's one of 20 test results. So that could easily be overlooked. And then the question is, if you know about it earlier, can you do something about it? Is there something worth doing about it? I think at the moment, we probably still wouldn't treat the people we've got MGUS, that I think Hung spoke about, or smoldering myeloma, unless there's risk to tell them they're going to progress. So sometimes knowing about it doesn't change what we do, because you don't want to put someone through treatment earlier because of the side effects, unless you've got something very good to nip in the bud.
I'm sorry. I think that's. We would love to chat to you for so much longer. Thank you for a really wonderful talk from Cindy. I'm just going to, with a little token, some. You get Hags all the time, but you can have some more. Yeah, that's right. Give them to those beautiful babies. And that was the best cameo I've ever seen at a conference. Thank you, Cindy. And I'm going to hand over.
Do you want to run and get them to come in? Yeah. Sorry, guys. Last minute details. Look, we are going to be serving afternoon tea shortly, but we know because as professionals, we often sit in rooms and have days of lectures, and we know how your brain feels at the end of it. So I know for those of you who are currently on treatment, it feels like you've got chemo brain twice doubled. So we wanted to sort of, before afternoon tea, just kind of switch things around a little bit. And so I'm very pleased to welcome a special performance for you guys from the Adelaide Vocal Union. Now they're a male a cappella choir. They were founded in 2015 as a male four-part harmony chorus to learn and perform barbershop and other genres of a cappella singing. So they proudly represent the central region of SANT within the Barbershop Harmony Australia. They're also very keen to always find new members. So if anyone's inspired by the performance today, reach out. I've got some pamphlets over there. And if you're really impressed with the performance today, they are also performing on Sunday, October 29 at 3:30 at the Norwood Town Hall. If we can turn the mics off, guys, and leave.
This thing called love, I just can't handle it. This thing called love, I must get around to it. I ain't ready. Crazy little thing called love. Well, this thing called love, it cries in a cradle all night. It swings. Like a jellyfish, I kinda like it. Crazy little thing called love. There goes my baby. She knows how to rock and roll. She drives me crazy. She's a holly gold sweeper. She makes me in a cocoa sweat. Ba ba ba. Ba ba ba. Da 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 da. I gotta be cool. Get here. I get on my tracks, take a back seat, hitchhike. Take a long ride on my motorbike until I'm ready.
vocal union. I'd say the boy band, but the man band. We've got one more song. It is our most requested. It is our last, and then you're free. This is I Can't Give You Anything But Love. One, two, three.
I can't give you anything but love, baby.
Baby,
that's the only thing I've plenty of, baby. Scheme a while, we're sure we'll find some happiness. And I guess all those things you've always pined for, gee, I'd like to see you looking swell, baby.
Baby,
diamond bracelets Woolworth doesn't sell, baby. Till that lucky day, you know darn well, baby, I can't give you anything but love. Gee, I'd like to see you looking swell, baby.
Baby, a
diamond bracelets Woolworth doesn't sell, baby. Till that lucky day, you know darn well, baby, I can't give you anything. Oh, ain't got a barrel of money,
honey.
I can't give you anything. Oh, my love's a many splendid thing. I can't give you anything. Oh, I got plenty of nothing, but I got plenty of love.
You can leave your hat on, boys. Is this, are the mics back on? Oh, sorry. I hope everyone heard that. I said, you can leave your hat on, boys. That was so good. I love it. Okay, we've got our closer. I just wanted to introduce our fierce leader, our CEO, Mark Henderson. He's new to us at Myeloma Australia. He joins us with a background of a strong track record in the not-for-profit sector. He has held senior leadership positions with Lifeline Australia, Australasian Housing Institute, and a range of other entities. As is the case with many organisations who have been fortunate enough to survive the pandemic, there is much work to be done in securing new funding sources to sustain the service in the short term. This is Mark's immediate focus, and he just wants a little bit of your time before we head off and have some of those yummy treats and head and send you home. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Megan. I'm not sure if I'm on yet. First of all, I won't be singing anything to you. Although I did pick up a few tones there, Sandy, from you a bit earlier, so I think you've got a spot next time you're in South Australia. And I can promise you we're going to be on our feet and out of here in about 10 minutes, so it's not going to be a long presentation for you today. But I just want to thank you all for giving up your time to come in today. It's really fantastic to have the people of Adelaide here. And it's been great to hear from our specialists, our doctors and our nursing teams, and everyone's here today to provide the insight that they've got. First of all, I want to note, Roy and Marilyn, I think they said 51 years. All right, so there's a few people in this room who want to know the secret. So when you go out for afternoon tea, we're going to be lined up. We want to know the answer. I want to just tell you that my experience being here and the 9 months I've been with the organisation is very, very humbling. And it's really humbling to stand here today in front of you, patients, carers, and to be with you on the path and the journey that you're on. We feel very much part of your journey, and we're here to support you as much as we can. This quote I found kind of really summed up what I'm seeing in the last 9 months. You know, we're the willow, you're the willow, you're strong, you have to flex, you have to bend, you have to take the good days, and you're going to have to take some of the bad. But again, we want to let you know that Myeloma Australia, our nursing team, the specialists that you've seen here today, we're here for you on this ride. I just want to show you something now. I think it's really important that when you see people like me wearing suits with fancy titles, that you kind of know where we've come from or where I've come from. So this is a good example. So I grew up in the Riverina. I was one of 10 children. Does anyone know which one I might be? So I've been fighting that term my whole life. I'm now 47. This photo was taken in 1981, and I was really annoyed because I went into the studio and the photographer said, "You can sit in the little baby's chair." And I've been trying to fight that my whole life. I'm not a baby anymore. But what particularly my parents taught us as children is that we've got to fight pretty hard for... You've got to fight pretty hard when you go to the buffet with my family, but you've got to really fight for what you believe in, and you've got to stand up for people who can't stand up for themselves. And social justice was something that was really important in my upbringing. So my parents taught me that, and it's kind of led me on my career path to a degree. So this was an interesting growing up period. I suppose the only important thing to note as a good, and I think you've probably realised that, we're a very good Catholic family. So there's two things. We did have television at home, I think a couple of them at least. But there's one other organisation that looks after the Catholics beautifully, and that was the Collingwood Football Club. So we are proud members of the Collingwood Football Club, and I'm sure many of you here today are as well. So look, yeah. Yeah. The part of my job that I take really seriously, and it's really important that we're advocating for you in the community, is on things like funding. We had one of our senior professors here last night explain that the path to cure, if we're going to put a dollar figure on it, he believes it's $100 million to, let's use Hung's reference a bit earlier, the operational cure of myeloma. So when I first met him, I said, how long, how much? And this was the number, $100 million. Put your hand up if you think that's a lot. Okay, that's fair. Let me just talk about some of the highlight stats too. So we know 50 people in Australia are diagnosed with myeloma every week. There's 22,000 cases of myeloma across Australia as we stand here today. It's the number one, and this won't be a shock to any of you, this is the number one blood cancer, most expensive blood cancer to treat. Okay, so I'm just giving you some context. This is the amount of government funding Myeloma Australia gets. So our nursing staff that are here, our organisation is completely self-funded. We want to change that, clearly. We have to. We might get your help with that. And then I just want to give you some other context about where money flows inside the system. So these two causes are absolutely very important for the Australian community. Prostate cancer... There was 24,000 new cases of prostate cancer in 2022. You've got a 96% chance of survival post 5 years. If you recall some of the stats and slides you've saw from Hung and others and Cindy, it's for myeloma, it's about 55 to 60%. So breast cancer as well is very high. I think the 92% is the survival rate for breast cancer. So really important, both of those organisations and causes are really, really important. I just want to draw you to the bottom of those two examples. It's about $700 million spent on prostate cancer in Australia to support those with prostate cancer. And for breast cancer, it's over $1 billion. Okay, so that's a big number and really important. And it's really important for both those communities with that disease that the funding level is where it's at. A couple of others, again, I'm just trying to give you some context here. Fight MND, Neil Danaher has done a wonderful job with Fight MND. They've raised, since 2014, $70 million, of which 28 million of that came from the Commonwealth Government. There's 2,500 patients with MND in Australia at the present time. So if you remember, myeloma, 22,000. It's a big difference. Lifeline, which is an organisation close to my heart, and I spent time with them, 3,500 people each year die of suicide. It's a horrible tragedy. $6.3 billion was spent on suicide mental health related services in Australia in 2022. And I can tell you, it's well worth it. The money going into that cause is really, really important. So those who put their hand up about the 100 million, is 100 million still a lot of money? Of course, the answer is yes, but not in the context of other disease states. I'll tell you what it's not also in context with, is where money is being spent in the broader economy. And this is my little hobby horse at the moment. And I don't want to finish on a low, but it's really frustrating and annoying me at the moment. But the 730 report reported a couple of weeks ago that they believe $34 billion was wasted on infrastructure projects in Australia in the last 10 years. These are other projects that are currently active. So the Metro Rail project in Melbourne, I don't know if you would know that, but that was first forecast to be an investment of $50 billion was the forecast. They believe it'll run out to $200 billion. The Commonwealth Games, a very, very fancy sports carnival, it's been cancelled and they reckon the fee from the taxpayer is $630 million. It's a lot of money. My last little hobby horse, and sorry again to digress, through the pandemic, Qantas was given a lifeline of $2.7 billion. 2 days ago, they reported a profit of $2.5 billion, a record. So hopefully we all get a check in the mail that it came from us to them to get profitability in a very important airline. So we need to get better, and I say we being Myeloma Australia, in putting these numbers in front of politicians and decision makers that the myeloma community is really, excuse my French, but bloody important. And we need to see money flow into research to give people like Cindy and Hung and others the tools to be able to accelerate the operational cure that we're after. So I don't know if you know this guy, he's pretty important. So we've started that process, and again, I just want to thank Sandy for having the courage to come out and put his name out there in lights to say, this has got to change, people need to know about myeloma. Now, he will tell you this, he's not doing it to raise his own profile, that's not what he's about, but he knows his profile can do something for the people in this room. So I think we should put our hands together again for Sandy. We're also doing this thing called the Myeloma Impact Fund. We're going out to big business and government and saying, we need the 100 million. So you're going to start putting your hand in your pocket and give us this money. And the Myeloma Impact Fund will do things like help Cindy with her research. It will help put new services into the community. It will help the regions get better access to services and the like. So we're putting a name to it, and we want people to be accountable for helping us on this journey. Can I just tell you one other thing? I'm not sure if I should tell you this, but I'm going to anyway because I feel like I should. Sophie Wilson. Everyone know Sophie Wilson? Yeah. Yep, is she here? Sophie's not here. She's upstairs. We heard from Sophie yesterday what an awesome human she is. I was advised last night after our session that in 2 weeks' time, the Royal Adelaide Hospital's funding for her role ceases. Right? So some people might know that. So we don't reckon that's good enough. So we've got a bit of a activity now to actually start getting in front of media and government and other people so those kind of things can be overturned. So I think we'll be successful because I know politicians don't like bad media, potentially, and hopefully it won't go bad. We're also holding a fundraiser. So if you're in Melbourne, the 24th of November, we're holding a fundraiser. It's the first time we've ever done a fundraiser of this type. And in fact, Sandy's role is the first time we've ever had a spokesperson or someone with that profile representing myeloma. So we're going to try and leverage that and raise some really important funds on the 24th of November. So you'll see stuff come out in our marketing and the like. If you can get over for that, that'd be great to see you there. So, in summary, and then I'm going to get off and you can go and have some afternoon tea. Is 100 million still a lot of money? Is it worth it? Is it worth the fight to go and try and find it? I think the answer is yes, and that's the path that we're on, and we'll do our damnedest on your behalf to make sure that the myeloma community is well represented in the broader community. And that's it. I do have some last couple of things. Sorry, I just want to thank our speakers. I want to thank our sponsors. Again, we had a couple of sponsors, some of our pharmaceutical partners who put their hand up to help land this event, which is great. I want to thank Sandy. I want to thank Carolyn as well for coming over from Melbourne to support the venture today. Who else do I want to thank? I just want to make sure I've got it in the right order. I want to thank our nursing team who's standing in the back. I think they get... they need a round of applause for putting up with me, but secondly, just the work they do, they're just phenomenal, and you can feel the energy in the room over the last 2 days. So I want to thank them very much. Joe and Alicia, I want to thank them, the two local Myeloma Australia nurses in Adelaide, again, for the energy and effort you've put into getting a lot of people to this event as well. They deserve another round of applause. And lastly, and I said at the start, thank you to you, the patients and carers who've taken your time out of a busy Saturday, busy weekend to come and spend time with us. So thank you for being here as well. It's been wonderful. Now we've got a quick raffle. We talked about the Gilbert Street Hotel. I've never been to the Gilbert Street Hotel, but it sounds like I should. Now, the Gilbert Street Hotel were very generous in donating a $100 meal voucher that we're going to draw a raffle prize out now. But I didn't think only one Monica was enough, so I'm going to ring them on Monday and see if they'll donate another one. And if they won't, I'll donate it. So can you draw out the first one? I'll hold that. You can go, Monica. You can draw the first one, and then Sandy can draw the next one. F45 purple. Oh, yeah. Well done, Dave.
You can add the east-west link too to your...
Oh, yes. I think that was up there, actually. Was it? Yeah, I think so.
Shocking. purple. Rosie.
F47. There you go. Okay.
Sure, no problem. I just want to say that it's great to see so many to get together. And the reason for the Gilbert Street Hotel is that it started initially as a few, I think we were 18 first, a few that got together and just to share experiences and to meet each other rather than just texting, social media. And from there it's grown to about 40. So, and I know that when I was first diagnosed, 11 years ago, so I give hope to others, that I didn't know where to go or who to talk to, and I know that the support of each other is extreme, and together we can work on that.
Absolutely.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, round of applause for Monica. You good? Alicia, is there anything else? We're good. Thank you to our audio and video team down the back for your support. Thank you. And I think we're done. So everyone travelling, have a safe trip home. Thanks again for being here, and we wish you all the very best. And if you need us, just give us a ring. Thanks.